think there comes a point, and I think maybe it's the point when you realize you're an adult, where like this, like I guess there's probably a lot of tests to say like, oh, I'm an adult now. Like the day that you get ice out of the refrigerator and one cube falls on the floor, when you pick it up and throw it in the sink instead of just kicking it under the fridge, that's probably a good test of adulthood. Some of you kids are like, you used to do that too. I did. And your mom knows that you're doing it, and you need to stop because you're messing up the floor. There's a mold problem growing back there. And it's all your fault. But I think maybe one of the points at which I realized I was an adult was this day that I recognized that I didn't want to have to think about what I was going to eat for dinner. Have you been there? Where you're like, you're sitting there and you're like, what am I going to make for dinner? And understand, like, in my house, I'm not the one who makes most of the dinners or even a large part of the dinners, but even just my small contribution to the making of the dinner, I was like, I don't want to have to figure out what we're going to eat for dinner, because it seems like my whole life is just figuring out what we're going to have for dinner and then making it and then eating it and then cleaning up after it. And as soon as we're done cleaning up after it, I'm going to start thinking about what we're going to eat for the next meal, right? And I was like, this is welcome to adulthood. That's it, right there. It's just all about that. But in spite of that cycle, of that mundane nature of eating, there are some meals that really stand out to us, aren't there? That there's sometimes, like, if I say the best meal of your life, your mind may have just, even subconsciously, you went to it. And it may have been because the food was really, really good. Last week, Emily made a steak, and I've made my wife, I don't know, 100 steaks. And last week, we were sitting there at a restaurant, and she's eating a steak, and she said, I think this is the best steak of my life. I didn't make that steak, but it's fine. It's fine. It's probably the best steak of my life. Now I have a new challenge. I have to get better than the Longhorn Steakhouse, you know, and their mass-produced steak. It's fine. It wasn't even marinated, but it doesn't matter, you know. But that's going to stand out in her mind as this high watermark of steak. As I think back about my own sort of history of eating, there was a time when a friend gave us a free meal at the castle at Disney World, where they have all the princesses. All of some of you have been there, and like the food wasn't really even good. But my girls were just so excited to be inside Cinderella's castle and the whole thing. When I think about maybe the best meal of my life, when my daughter was born, when my wife was in labor, my parents called me and said, "Hey, we're here." Hospital. We were in Clarksville, Tennessee. They drove up from Texas. They said, we're here at the hospital. I went down to meet them, and they said, we're hungry, and then I ate lunch with them while my wife was in labor. It's been 12 years. She forgave me yesterday. So when my son was born, I said, I'm not going to eat until she eats. That was the longest day of my life. It was so long. Like, I wasn't even, like, you know, in labor. I was just there studying, like, and she, you know. But that night, we had pizza delivered. It was the best pizza ever. And I feel like it was probably twice as good for Haley, because she had done some work that day. Those, there are meals that stand out to us. And I think when we look at heaven, we think about what heaven will be like. There are several pictures that the Bible gives us, and there are several sort of, I think, creations that people have put together. Like, sometimes we get this picture of heaven, that heaven's going to just be everyone standing around singing all the time. And like, some of y'all don't like to sing, and so you're like, that doesn't sound like heaven to me. I don't think that's an accurate picture of what heaven is, right? Sometimes they talk about, well, the streets are made of gold. Okay, yeah, that sort of shows the value of human wealth in heaven, right? But then there's this sort of popular conception that we'll all be like these, like, cherubic kind of angels with wings and harps sitting on clouds. I don't think it's anything like that either. In fact, my favorite picture of what heaven's like is in Revelation chapter 19, which is the marriage supper of the Lamb. And it's this gigantic feast. It's a gigantic feast where all of God's children are brought together at the same table to eat together. Every nation, every tongue, every tribe, everyone brought together under the banner Christ to eat a meal together. I have a friend, and his one request about his funeral, he said, I just want you to bury me with a knife, fork, and spoon tucked right there in my lapel, because when I get to heaven, I'm going to eat everything. You can look at scripture. In fact, I think food is one of the lenses through which we can read the whole Bible. At the very beginning, right, there's a snake in the garden, and the story centered around what Adam and Eve should eat and what they shouldn't eat. You might look at your own life and say, hey, that's the story of my life too, what I should and shouldn't eat. But then you see that not only is there the story of the food there, but when you look at generations later as God sends the children of Israel into Egypt, what is it that sends them there? Hunger. They're searching after food. And when God decides to liberate them from slavery, the capstone event to their time of captivity, that capstone event is what? A meal, the Passover, where God's people gather together to eat together while the angel, that angel passes over them. And as they go into the promised land, God shows his provision by giving them food every morning. And as the spies look at the promised land, what is the thing that they're like, what is the thing that we need to tell people to make them want to go into the promised land? That it's a land of what? It's a land of milk and honey. You can read, and I can go on and on. I'm not going to right now, but you can go all through the Bible and see the importance of food and of a table connection. Because I think that's an important picture of what heaven is. I think that's an important picture of what the church is. And this month, we're going to look at some meals in Scripture. And we're going to look at the meals that Jesus ate in Luke. We're going to look at the meals that Jesus ate in the New Testament. We might go outside of Luke a little bit, but we're going to look at these meals that Jesus ate, and it's, I think there's a really important reason for it, right? When Jesus sometimes called himself the Son of Man, and there are three different popular things that are said, the Son of Man blank, right? When Jesus described himself, he says, the Son of Man came to first to seek and to save the lost. And he did. He came to seek and to save the lost. Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. The second thing is he said that the Son of Man came to give his life as a ransom for many. That's another role of the Son of Man. And the third is what the Pharisees said of Jesus. Right? And Jesus says it of himself, that the Son of Man came eating and drinking. And when the Pharisees saw Jesus eating and drinking, they're highly critical of it. I guess they wanted their religious leaders to come hungry and thirsty, and is not eating and drinking. And Jesus says, no, you're right, I came eating and drinking. And those three things that tell us something important, the first two are why Jesus came. He came to seek and to save the lost. He came to give his life as the ransom for many. But the third one, he came eating and drinking. That's not why he came, that's how he came. He came eating and drinking. And in doing that, he sets an example for us, for how it is that we are to live. He doesn't want his followers starving and thirsty. He wants us eating and drinking, but he wants us to do it in a very particular way, because the way that he ate and drank was to reveal the kingdom of God to lost people. He ate and drank, and a part of that was his mission to reveal the kingdom of God to lost people. And so, this morning, I want us to begin this idea of understanding that what we experience at the table is grace. Sometimes when we talk about, grace connected to the table, we say that we gather around the table and we want grace. And we say grace. Bow your heads, we're going to say grace. Right? Say grace is important, don't neglect that. But we have to remember that when we gather together, that Jesus, when he begins his prayer, his model prayer, he says, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And he doesn't just mean that sort of a symbolic thing, but he's saying that when you eat bread, you are receiving grace. To have bread is receiving God's grace. And you might say, well, yeah, but hold on. I get my bread from H-E-B. So I think I'm receiving H-E-B's grace. No. In order for H-E-B to make that bread, there are a million pieces that have to work perfectly for us to go to the grocery store and buy that bread. And we can see throughout the Old Testament, especially times when crops fail, when there's pestilence, when there's disasters. How about this? Tell me about that meal. Think about that meal when the power came back on a couple of weeks ago. Right, that first meal that you made back in your kitchen, wasn't that great? And when you made that meal back in your kitchen, when you went to the panel and you microwaved your ramen noodles or whatever that meal was, right, when you hit those buttons and there was lights and sound, electricity that helped you make food, you did what I did. You said, oh, thank God. Thank God the power's back. Thank God we have this. And if you're like, no, I don't really feel bread is really grace, go just take the next 2 weeks and eat keto, right? Take 2 weeks and don't eat any bread, and I'll bring some Red Lobster Cheddar Bay biscuits to your house, and you will know the grace of the Lord through those Cheddar Bay biscuits, because God tells us that there's something about that table experience that is important. It is that through that table experience that we experience God's grace and we extend it to others. Jesus talks about this in Luke chapter 14. In Luke chapter 14, I'll get to those verses in just a second. In Luke chapter 14, he is having dinner with a group of Pharisees. And while he's there eating dinner with them, they try to lay traps for him. They lay these sort of like verbal traps where they're asking him questions and trying to get him to get himself in trouble. And it never works out for them the way that he thinks it, the way they think it will, right? And they sort of ask questions in the first six verses that he heals a man. And he does this to expose their legalism and show how they've twisted the law. And he silenced them. And then verses 7 through 11, he rebukes the guests at this place for taking the best seats in the house. He says, you know, you shouldn't have gone and seated yourselves in a place of honor because you didn't know if somebody more honorable than yourself may have come, which is him. And he, you know, talks about how the proud will be humbled and the humbled will be exalted. And he does this in those verses 7 through 11. But then in verses 12 through 24, he says, he shows a picture of how they should be practicing their kingdom hospitality, how they should be gathering at the table together. I'm going to begin at verse 12. He said also to the man who had invited him, when you give a dinner or a banquet, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbors, lest they also invite you in return and you be repaid. But when you give a feast, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed because they cannot repay you. For you will be repaid at the resurrection of the just. He says, you should invite people that you don't normally invite. In fact, this is how we ought to invite people to our parties. Because he isn't just rebuking this man, he's rebuking everyone there and everyone here. Because when we have parties, when we have dinners, we invite the same guest list that he does. We invite people that we like. We invite our friends. We invite our families. We invite people that will probably in turn invite us to their homes. And Jesus says, don't do that. Invite people who aren't necessarily your best friends, who aren't necessarily your relatives, people who can't pay you back. Several years ago, Haley and I had a New Year's Eve party, and we invited a typical guest list, our friends, family, people that had invited us to their homes, and we were having this New Year's Eve party, so we were going to start about 8 o'clock. The invitation was 8 o'clock, and then we were going to eat. We had a waffle bar, which is basically just everybody makes their own waffles, and they put just everything on it. And so we had waffle makers set up, and syrup, and chocolate, and strawberries, and whipped cream, and Slim's Chicken, which is like, if you've never had Slim's Chicken and you're ever in a town, now, if you've never had Slim's Chicken, but you're in a town that's near a town that has a Slim's Chicken, just go. Trust me. It's worth it. It's like Chick-fil-A's younger, cooler brother. Anyway, it's really good. So we've got Slim's Chicken there to make chicken hot waffles, and we're ready. And the thing is that my friend Jeff got there at 7 o'clock. Everybody was supposed to get there at 8 o'clock. Jeff got there at 7 o'clock. His parents dropped him off. See, Jeff, when he was born, he had a brain injury. He had a brain injury, and because of that brain injury, he just thought and saw the world very differently. And we had been friends elementary school all the way through high school, and then when I went back to pastor in Texarkana, we reconnected. But Jeff, again, he saw the world differently. He didn't always necessarily get the times and things right, but when he got dropped off at 7 o'clock, there was no way I was going to be like, no, dude, come back in an hour. Right? I was like, come on in, you know. And so Jeff and I are sitting there, and food set up over there. I'm starting to set up the food. At one point, I sit down on the couch, and we've got this sort of party music going, and Jeff says, Chip, thank you so much for inviting me to this party. I was like, hey, you're welcome. And he said, this is the first New Year's Eve I'll spend with friends. Every other New Year's Eve I've ever spent, I've been. there, little couch reclining. He looks at him and says, "This is a cool party, bro, but you know what makes it a lot cooler? As if there were some other people here. Because I'm looking at you and you and you and you, and y'all are all just the same. You've got nobody else here. What makes this party a lot better is if there were some other people here." Now, Jesus isn't saying you can't hang out with your friends. He isn't saying that you can't hang out with your family. See, Jesus went to Lazarus' home numerous times. There were people that he hung out with more than other people. He didn't spread out his time evenly. Right? We see the picture of the early church, that the early church was together often. And we know, in fact, the scriptures tell us that the world will know we're Christians by our love for one another first. By our love for one another. And so we should be about loving each other. But what Jesus is saying here is he's saying, don't limit your guest list. Don't limit your guest list. The question that I want us to ask ourselves here right now is, how much of our socializing, how much of our social life is built around paybacks? How much of your social life is built around paybacks? Or the potential of paybacks? The Millers invited us over to their house. We had dinner at their house last month, so we probably need to invite them over to have dinner at our house this month. Okay, you're right. I guess we should do that. It's time to make a birthday party invitations. So who do we invite? Well, let's go through the list of all the birthday parties our kids have been invited to this year. We've got to make sure to invite every kid that invited our kids to a birthday party. We've got to invite them to our birthday party because we don't want those kids to feel left out. We certainly don't want those parents of those kids to think that their kids have been left out, because then they'll start leaving our kids out of things because parents are vengeful.
I was
work this out. It'll be fine. It'll work out. And I really don't have a part in it. And there's this guy. And this guy hears Jesus' rebuke. And he tries to sort of throw something else out there. And Jesus says, oh, no. No, no, no. You're missing the point. Okay. Verse 15. This is what it says. It says, then when one of those who reclined at table with him heard these things, he said to him, blessed is everyone who will eat bread in the kingdom of God. And Jesus must have been thinking, what story were you listening to? What were you listening to that you would say this? See, Jesus has said, what you're doing, the way you're practicing hospitality is wrong. And this guy says, everyone's blessed by God if they're enjoying God's bread. Jesus, you're missing the point. Jesus doesn't let this guy just kind of stand there and let his idea sort of fester in the minds of people, because Jesus is making a point. He's making a point. He's going to make the point. He's not going to let this guy's this sort of witticism stand there. And so and then in verse 16, he says this, but Jesus said to him, a man once gave a great banquet and invited many. And at the time of the banquet, he sent his servants to say to those who had been invited, come, for everything is now ready. So the way that they did invitations back then is not common to the way we do invitations now. If I was having a dinner party, I would invite you one time. I'm going to give you one invitation, and you know that's probably it. But the way they did invitations was double invitation, which is a lot more like weddings in the age of Pinterest. You know what I'm talking about? Like a year before a couple gets married, they send you a card with a picture of them, you know, like wearing denim jumpers or something, and they're smiling, and it says, save the date. I don't even have a calendar to put this date on, because this is next year, but I'm supposed to save the date now. Okay, fine, I'll save the date. I'm going to put this in a drawer and forget about it for 6 months. But they send an initial invitation. And then, once it's like right around the corner, then you get the invitation that's like got all the extra pieces of like tissue paper, and it's silver stamped and embossed, and it says they pledge their troth love, and uses language from the King James Version, and you're like, I think there's a wedding here, right? And that's the real invitation. And so that's how they practiced invitations at the time. They would send out an announcement to say, you're invited, it's going to be coming sometime soon. So it sort of says, save the date, and then there's another invitation that says, now is the time. Come today. And so Jesus tells this story, and they would have been familiar with the way these invitations work. And so he sends out this second invitation. Come, for everything is now ready. Verse 18, but they all alike began to make excuses. The first said to him, I bought a field, and I must go out and see it. Please have me excused. And another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I go to examine them. Please have me excused. And another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. So the servant came and reported these things to his master. Then the master of the house became angry and said to the servant, go out quickly to the streets and lanes of the city and bring in the poor, crippled, blind, and lame. And the servant said, sir, what you commanded has been done, and still there is room. And the master said to the servant, go out to the highways and hedges and compel people to come in, that my house may be filled. For I tell you, none of those men who are invited shall taste my banquet. So he does this. See, Jesus has just rebuked everyone for the way they practice hospitality, and then he shows how God is practicing hospitality. He's going to show how the kingdom of heaven is truly like. And he says, basically, this is the first guy who speaks. He says, you know, everyone is blessed who takes the kingdom. And there's a lot of people who talk about heaven who aren't going to be invited. That's what Jesus, bottom line of this. Jesus is saying there's a lot of people who are talking about heaven who aren't going to be invited, who aren't going to actually go. See, that first invitation, that RSVP, that saved the date, that was a representation of the law and the prophets, that God sent out his message to the world, to his people, to say, there is a banquet coming. The banquet is coming. There is a banquet coming. It's going to be massive. It's going to be amazing. Get ready for it. And throughout the Old Testament, that is the message, that one is coming, that something is coming, that God is revealing himself to mankind, but the ultimate revelation of God has yet to come. And then Jesus says the second invitation is where it comes along and says, it is time. And that's what Jesus did. He says, I've come to say, it's time. all these preparations, all these things that were before, that was nice and that was good, but this is the time. And people, Jesus' experience of talking to people across Israel at that time was that he heard a lot of excuses. He heard a lot of excuses. And granted, these aren't necessarily point by point exactly the excuses he heard. I've bought a field and I have to go see it. Let's say like you have property. You have to go, like you can't take a day away from your property. So because of your property, you can't do what God's calling you to do. And there was a popular sentiment in Israel at the time that God's people were tied to the land, were tied to the land of Palestine. And Jesus says, that's not it. It's not just about being people of this land. It's about being God's people. There are people who say, I'm sorry, I can't. I have financial interests. I've invested in these 5 oxen. Or I have all these possessions. I have this great wealth. And they tell Jesus no. They said, I can't follow after you because of their wealth, because of their business. There are people who say, well, I've just started this relationship. I have this new wife. And because of these relationships, I can't. I have to go and bury my father. I have to. All these things. They said, that's why I can't follow after Jesus. Why do people say no to Jesus? These reasons. Why do people today still say no to Jesus? These same reasons. I can't go. I can't go. I can't serve. I can't do because I'm so tied to a place. I'm so invested in a place, in a house, in a mortgage, in land. I just can't go. I can't go because my business interests won't allow me to serve God. My business interests won't allow me to serve God. So I'll have to tell my boss yes and my God no. This relationship is so important. I'll have to just tell God no because of this relationship. See, people are still saying no to Jesus for the same reasons. It's not because of some sort of theological issue or some philosophical difference. It's this. It's an issue of heart. It's an issue of heart. And Jesus says, because of this, that he will reach out, that the gospel will move outside of Israel to the Gentiles. That it will move outside of God's original people to the poor, the crippled, the blind, the lame. It'll move out to the highways and the hedges. And let's be clear about it. That's where he found us. To these Jews, we were the ones in the highways and the hedges. We were the lame, the blind. We were the ones who were helpless. To these Jews practicing Judaism at that time, that's us. And God in his grace reached out to us and invited us to his table. And so we are able to take part in his table because of the gracious invitation of God. And because we have received that gracious invitation, because every time that we gather around a table, it is a foretaste. It is a foretaste of the ultimate table experience we will have in eternity. Because every time we gather around that table, it is a little piece of heaven here and now. Because we receive grace at that table, we are to use that table to extend grace to others. And so, we, like these servants, we're to go out and we're to invite the poor, the crippled, the blind, the lame. We're to be by the highways and the hedges. And we are to invite people to come to our... And right there, how did you fill in that blank? I know you were thinking what I was going to say. I said it's natural. We should invite people to come to our... I know. I want to say church too. I want to say church. I want to say that we need to invite people to our church because church is a nice neutral ground. Right? It's a nice neutral ground to have strangers in church. It's kind of like, oh, there's a stranger. Let's have them fill out a card and stare at them. Hello, stranger. Right? To invite people to church is nice, it's neutral, it's really comfortable to invite the poor, the lame, the blind, the sick, the highways and hedges, dwellers to church. Really comfortable. But that's not what Jesus is called. He says to invite them to our homes. To invite them to our tables. To open up our homes with our piles of dirty laundry. With our chipping paint, but that one window that got cracked in the storm that you're going to get around to fixing it, and by that storm, I meant the one like 5 years ago, but we're going to just say that storm so people might think that it was Laura. is invite people into our homes that don't have the newest, the floors are still travertine. That's where my floors are still travertine. My backsplash is atrocious. There is no granite anywhere in this house. But we invite them in anyway. We invite them in. We invite them to our table that is nothing more than, my table is literally three plywood sheets glued together and put on metal legs. I think I made it for $75. We invite them to our table, not just our church. We invite them into our lives, not just into our community. This is how we practice kingdom hospitality. This is what we're called to do. So the question for us, really there's two of them this morning that we need to address. The question are these. First, are you going to the king's banquet? Are you going to the king's party? Because the invitation has been sent out. And I would think that on a Sunday morning in a Baptist church meeting in a gym, that if you're here, that you've already accepted the invitation to go to the king's table. That you've accepted that invitation. So maybe the better question for us is, are you looking forward to it? Are you looking forward to it? Are you anticipating it? When you sit down this afternoon at lunch, when you gather around whatever table it is that you find yourself, when you receive that grace, do you see it as grace? Or do you see it just as another meeting? Do you see it just as another meal that you had to think about, you had to prepare, and you're going to have to clean up after? Or do you see it and say, this is God's grace that I am celebrating here. This is a foretaste of the banquet of the Lamb that I will enjoy one day in eternity. Which way do you see it? And the second question for us really is, are you practicing kingdom hospitality? Are you practicing kingdom hospitality? I'm going to spend the next several weeks, four, maybe 5 weeks, talking about kingdom hospitality. At a certain point towards the end, I'm going to challenge you to practice kingdom hospitality. I'm going to challenge you to invite someone into your home that's not been there before. I'm going to challenge you to invite someone into your home to have dinner with you that you don't know what church they go to, that you don't know what their eternal destination is. I'm going to challenge you to do that. And I know there are a lot of ways that we can push back against that, right? A lot of ways that we want to push back against it and say, oh, but there's coronavirus. There's coronavirus. Yeah, I get it. And if you're immunocompromised, then maybe this isn't a thing for you to do. Maybe you have to figure out a way to practice kingdom hospitality while observing social distancing guidelines. That's fine. Just because you can't be present with someone doesn't mean that you can't open up your home, open up your life to somebody. Maybe there's other ways. But for most of us, we're going to work. Most of us, we're going to the grocery store. Most of us are going out to eat at restaurants. And maybe it's, maybe you need to take everybody's temperature at the door to your home. If you want to, that's fine. In fact, I've got one of those little thermometers that you shoot people in the head with. And I've gotten remarkably comfortable with walking up to strangers and raising my hat so that they can point a thing in my forehead. So maybe that's how you practice it. But I'm going to challenge you at some point to practice kingdom hospitality. And I don't think the coronavirus exempts us from kingdom hospitality. You might push back about it and say, this is scary just because it's scary to have somebody in your home. Yeah, they might be scared too. But if they're willing to come, you should be willing to have them. I get a little nervous every time I have a new person into my house. I do. I'm worried that there's going to be judgment, that my house is going to not measure up, that like they're going to have an expectation that the pastor's house is, it's perfect, right? Like it's flawless. The kids are well behaved. Right? They're just going to be perfect. Like everything's going to be this sort of Norman Rockwell picture of perfection. It's not how we live. Nobody can ever measure up to that. So we invite people in anyway. It can be scary. You might want to push back and say, I'm just too busy. Just so busy. Too busy to eat. You're too busy to eat. Because I'm looking around. And I don't know if anybody in here looks too busy to eat. Right? We're all going to eat at some point or another. The issue is, are we going to eat by ourselves? Because at a certain point, this was practiced. At a certain point in our country, we invited our neighbors over. I haven't seen it. I was born in the 70s. I haven't seen it, but I've heard tell of it. I've heard tell of it that there was a time when neighbors talked in their front yards, when you invited people over to sit on your front porch and drink tea or lemonade. That there was a time when you would celebrate together with people in your life who just happened to live near you. I've heard tell of it. But at some point we traded out life on the front porch for life behind locked doors sitting in front of televisions. At a certain point, the TV dinner became a thing. At a certain point, we traded the big table that we would dine at with family and friends for little tray tables that we would put in front of our couches and recliners. And we let the TV be our engagement for the evening instead of our neighbors, instead of strangers. So yeah, maybe you're too busy, maybe it's scary. I get it. Maybe you'd say it's too costly. Heard this one. In fact, the very first time I ever preached about kingdom hospitality, and I tried to encourage the church that I was pastoring to practice kingdom hospitality, I had two senior adult ladies who were both just incredibly godly women, learned, you know, they had studied their Bibles for years and years and faithful, and I had two women who had vastly different responses to this. In fact, they were friends and they lived around the corner from each other. Their backyards touched. Somebody, like one's daughter and granddaughter, they like her grandson, they had gotten married, like they were connected, right? But vastly different approaches to this. One came to me and chewed me out and told me that she was on a fixed income and could not do this. She was on a fixed income and could not do this. And how dare I ask her to do this? And I said, it's not me, it's Jesus. Take it up with him. The other came to me, equally fixed income, equal lifestyle. And she said, I invited my neighbor over for tea. I invited my neighbor over for tea. I haven't used my teacups in years. She hadn't used her teacups since before her husband had died, 10, 12 years earlier. She said, but I invited this neighbor over for tea. She's a single mom. She told me all about her story and that she grew up Catholic but hasn't been in church in a long time. Within 3 months, that lady was coming to our church. Why? Well, because our music was amazing. And because I'm such an amazing preacher, right? No. She came to our church because she knew that Francis loved her. She knew that Francis loved her enough to open her doors, to open her home, to invite her to have a seat at her table. This place, I love it. I love Orange, Texas. I love North Orange Baptist Church. I love gathering with you guys every week to praise the Lord together, to have a time of celebration every Sunday. To me, it's like a party, but I tell you what would make this party a lot better. Make this party a lot better if it wasn't just you and me. Make this party a lot better if it wasn't just you and me. It'd be a lot cooler party if Orange, Texas was all in here together. If all of our neighbors, strangers, if the poor, the crippled, the blind, the lame, the dwellers of the highways and hedges, if they were all able to gather in our homes and to gather together as a church, that'd be pretty great. It can happen. But it doesn't happen by just inviting people to church. It happens by inviting people into our homes. My hope and prayer is that in the next few weeks, that God will reveal someone in your life that you can invite in, that you can practice kingdom hospitality, that you can receive God's grace through the table, and that you can use your table to extend God's grace to others. We're going to have a time of invitation. Let us pray together as our musicians and pastor Russell come forward. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you for the chance be a part of your table. God, I'm so glad that in spite of my sin, in spite of my failures, in spite of the darkness, I still dwell in, that you extend your grace to me, that you give me daily bread that is a picture of the feast that awaits. Lord, I pray that Lord, I would further pray that if there's any here today that doesn't know you, who's not experienced your grace, who does not have a reservation for a seat at your table, I pray that your Spirit would move in their heart today. That today they'd stop making excuses of place or of business or of relationships, but say, today I will follow Jesus as my Lord and Savior.